A Glimpse of Benguet in the 16th Century Onwards. Here is an untold fascinating story on how a stranger man had a big impact on Benguet generation. Part 1 Introduction. A glimpse of Benguet during the 16th century may be dim because there were no records to show. Oral traditions which started way back towards the end of the 17th century may give us a slight picture of how Benguet was populated. And how it was influenced by a strange man who came to the place. He had used it as his hiding place against his enemies for many years. Perhaps the story of this strange man could give us a glimpse of Benguet past. Sometime in 1823, a popular family name came out in Kapangang who descended from this strange man and was retold and retold from generation to generation, that is the marriage of Jojo and Sayod, one among the daughters of that caveman. It is in this lineage that started the peopling of Kapangang and neighboring places as time went by. Sometime in the 1830s, Spanish navigator had landed at what we call La Trinidad. In a few years there came the Americans. That was 1898. At this time, there were no evidence that the Itas, Indonesians, and the first wave of Malays were found in Benguet. The resemblance of the Indonesians are found in Kalinga, specifically in Tanadan in the early 1960s, and the remnants of the first wave of the Malays were found in the northwest of MT province. Their absence in the locality of Benguet was maybe a result of blending blood, or that they automatically have vanished as the years went by. As you continue to read this journal, maybe you could guess some of the reasons why. Part 11 A Lone British Struggler. Towards the end of the 17th century, a queer man, with long beard, tall nose, and height, was roaming around the forest. He was living alone. He was assumed to be a strange being in the wilderness. Later he was known as Doughen by the century-old folks and was handed down from generation to generation. The few old folks were ignorant as to who he was. They simply believed that he was a strange being in the wilderness. As time went by and as the story went on, the descendants believed that he was a German. Later in this contemporary period, his reality was discovered by a Filipino U.S. Navy named Victor Lacadon. He was an Ibaloya native of Kapanan and Tublay. Upon continuous researching, where that ancestor came from, while in the U.S. Naval Force, he found out that that man was actually named Ruzzel Doughen. He was a soldier from Buckingham, England, who among others were sent to conquer the Philippines from Spain. It was due to the Seven Years' War 1756-1763 between France and England. Spain was an ally of France. Picture of Victor Lacadon. A fourth generation from the British blood, a U.S. Navy and a Filipino in Ibaloy of Kapanan and Tublay. Her mother was Sabot, third generation. Arrival of the British soldier in the Philippine shore 1762. Based on Philippine history books, October 1762 there were British soldiers who attempted to capture Manila. At that time, more than 200 years the Spaniards stayed in Manila. With the help of the Filipinos, Manila was strongly guarded against incoming enemies. The British soldiers could not land easily. It was decisively natural for them to search for another place to anchor. It must be San Fernando or Pangasinan or any. Let us see the story of the old folks. From the story of the old folks handed down by generations, that strange man came up from San Fernando to escape the Spanish enemy. He traveled across the thick virgin forest of La Union and Kapanan. Then he arrived at the eastern mountain of Kapanan, where he found a cave. He made it as his dwelling home. This is later to be known as Domita Katawan term or Shaman i.e. Ibaloy term. This is located at now the barangay of Pangayan, municipality of Kapanan, and province of Benguet in the Cordillera administrative region. This man, accordingly, had lived by hunting wild animals. He would toast it in a fire inside the cave as his food. He merely gathered wild fruits for him to survive. At that time, there were rare people in the place. If there were, they could be counted. They were living by means of the Kaingin system. They hunted wild animals for their viand. There were no rice field at that time until 15 years before the close of the 18th century. And so their staple food was camote. One time while that queer man was reconnoitering around the place, he spotted a woman digging camote. It was a small kaingin. He went near her. The woman was frightened, but the man was friendly. He shared some of the wild fruits he had gathered. When her kayabang basket was filled with kamote, she started to go home and the man followed. He saw where she was going home. Upon sighting the house, he went back to his cave home. Every time that the woman would go to the Kapangan, the queer man would meet her. He shared toasted meat that he hunted in the forest. And they would eat together. Finally the woman got pregnant. Wild fruits given by Ruzzel Doughen to the lady. The parents were surprised why she was pregnant yet she has no husband. In their belief, she must be taken by bad spirit. Therefore they have to bury her alive, but then she pleaded for mercy. She requested that until the baby inside her womb be born. When the baby was born, the baby looked like the queer man whom they thought was a poget, wild being in the forest. The queer man was invited to come home with the woman. The woman complied. The queer man obediently followed and they went home together. After talking with the man, they fixed their marriage. From there on he was accepted within the family circle. The man lived with the family of the woman until he died. Assuming a lifespan of 80 years old and based on their arrival in the Philippines 1762, he must have lived for 60 years in Kapangan and 20 years in England. It could be estimated that he was alive until the year 1823. When he died, he was placed in a wooden coffin. The wooden coffin was placed in the cave where he once made it his shelter home. The coffin was preserved naturally in the cave and until now it exists at Domita Pongayan, Kapangan. Now, it is made as one of the tourist spot of Kapangan. The picture of Ruzzel Doughen's coffin. According to the old folks that queer man didn't have a child to only one woman. He must have scattered his genes around the neighboring places where he could find people. This was very possible because he was free to roam around. There were no Spanish enemy in the area, but the fact is that his coffin is found at the Domita cave until now. It indicates that he did not leave his first wife at Pongayan. With man's ability to move here and there and considering that there was no family planning at that time, it could be that many of them survived and had multiplied gradually. Thus the way Benguet started its population. In the early 1900 up to the 1950s, blood relationships was very evident. This was seen evidently during Kaneo. All relatives were invited formally. The family would send a messenger to invite them to attend the Kaneo or family feast. Relatives from Tublay, Sablan, Trinidad, Itagon, Baguio, Atok and Kaibungan and also Baguilan in La Union were invited. This was to maintain their closeness as relatives so they won't forget one another. This was a strong belief of the older folks. This was when population here in Benguet was very scarce. There was no other ways of meeting unlike nowadays. Follow the story and you will get more impressions. The next story would be about Jojo and Sayod in the second generation.